When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they could go and anoint Jesus' dead body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they came to the tomb. They were saying to each other, "Who's going to roll away the stone from the entrance for us?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, and it was a very large stone. Going into the tomb, they saw a young man in a white robe seated on the right side, and they were startled. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He isn't here. Look, here's the place where they laid him. Go, tell his disciples, especially Peter, that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there, just as he told you." Overcome with terror and dread, they fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid.
Communion's in my spot. So, who has ever heard of this ending in the Gospel of Mark? This Easter story. Bring that ending back up here, Barry. Overcome with terror and dread, they fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Yay, happy Easter. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Yeah, not so much in this gospel. In fact, people hated this gospel's ending, not the story, so much that they added on to it, scribes of later years, because it can't end there. It just can't. That's not possible. And so if you read on, if you want to bring out your Bibles from the pews, there's a longer ending from Mark chapter 16 that goes on, and there's even some snake handling in there, which is where certain denominations get that from. But this is the original ending. Women overcome with terror and dread, and they were the ones who had at least the bravery and the courage to show up. The men hadn't even come to the tomb. And they were the ones who fled, saying nothing to anyone because they were so afraid. It's hard, 2,000 plus years later, to think of this beginning, to think of something other than the excitement of dawn and all of the joyousness of all of the color and all of the assurance that there is life after death. But there wasn't here. And so I just want us to center a moment in acknowledging that there's real terror and there's real fear in the world for good reasons. There are things that have happened to these disciples under Roman occupation that should never happen to any human being. And there are people here with stories of great injustices and things that they are going through that should never have to happen to any human being. Because the fact of the matter is, there is more than we can handle in life. And there is very good reason to be terribly afraid. And there is very good reason for when we get to our shut down places. So what do we do with this? What Easter sermon just sits here in the fear and terror and dread and no one telling anyone anything? The greatest story ever told, the best turning point, the moment of greatest hope, and no one ever tells anyone anything because they're so overcome with terror and dread. When I first heard this from my seminary professor, I didn't know what to do, and she let us sit there in the brokenness of what did you just do to us, and so now what do we do with us? But then she offered this piece of hope. She asked us to remember that the gospel according to Mark was the first gospel to be written, and so for a while it was the only gospel. It was the only piece that told the story of Christ. And that wrote it down. Now, there are lots of people, right, disciples telling the stories, but then those first disciples began dying because they expected Jesus to come and to return and for the kingdom of God to be present in their lifetime. But that didn't happen. And so as the eyewitnesses, as those first disciples who followed Jesus and were there were dying, people were scrambling in the early church. Wait a second, we got to write this down. We've got to be able to share the story. And so for a while, this was the story. And it ended in terror and dread. But if you ever remember listening to CDs before we had playlists, you came to the end of the CD, and what happened? It looped back right to the beginning. And Barry, what is the beginning of the gospel according to Mark? The beginning of the good news about Jesus Christ, God's son, happened just as it was written about in the prophecy of Isaiah. Look, I am sending my messenger before you. He will prepare your way, a voice shouting in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord. Make his path straight. What happens when we listen to that in an Easter promise? Prepare the way of the Lord. A voice shouting in the wilderness of dread and terror and fear. Prepare the way of the Lord. The beginning of the good news about Jesus Christ, God's Son. And then all of a sudden, we start reading all of the stories again. All of the healings, all of the feedings, all of the waves and the wind that were calmed. And all of a sudden, we see in the story what we couldn't see before. We see a risen Christ. We see hope. We see life. We see everything that we already knew in a completely different and transformed way. And so we will have endings. We will be overcome with fear and dread. But the good news that is offered to us is that we follow one who can make those endings melt away into new beginnings. New beginnings in which there is a way prepared for us. In which there is a path made straight through terror and dread. In which there is good news in the midst of despair. And that is a hope that is timeless and is a message and an assurance that every single person needs all around the world. This is our hope that when we come up to the endings, whatever diagnosis it is, whatever shock and trauma it is, however much it shuts us down and makes us completely incapable of doing anything or saying anything, even and especially in those worst places, come the good news about Jesus Christ, who knows wilderness and is preparing a way for us. That's the good news we celebrated in the communion. That's the good news of having gone through absolutely every worst of the injustice that this world can put on us. The rejection that this world can put on us, the judgment of value that this world can put on us, to shut down in the midst of that kind of evil and darkness, but have someone who knows the way through it and can show us the way too. And that's also why we don't ever do this journey alone. Because when we are in our worst shutdown place and we can't say anything or do anything, we need others who aren't in that worst place, who can witness to us and remind us that there are beginnings that are possible, who can sing for us when we can't even open our mouths, who can pray for us when all we can do is shout obscenities at God. That's why we do this journey together, because we make our way together. Because God works in us, through us, with us, and in spite of us. And that's why we're building these small groups together, because it's not just enough to come and gather on Sunday. Life happens in full and brutal force every moment of the day. And so we're going to need time to know that there's safety, to know that there's community, to know that there's love, to know that there is hope. So here are two testimonies of a reason to hope.
Good morning, Epworth. My name is Karen, and I'm here to share some thoughts with you about the small class ministries, which just goes to show how powerful God is, because when I first heard about the small classes, I couldn't see the need or the reason for them. Oftentimes, when we're presented with a new class or a new group, we do wonder about their worth, we question their value, we wonder if they can truly change our lives and our walk with God. And in a world that is just busy, we wonder if they're worth our time and our effort. And I'm here to answer yes to all those questions. And also, in the shadow of some horrific events, I'm here to share with you why I think the small classes are more necessary than ever. Because we live in a world where the morning headlines and the evening newscast can bring us to tears. We live in a world where the outside noise is so pervasive that oftentimes we can't hear the inner voice of the Holy Spirit. So what I've learned is that we need a place. We need a holy space. We need a time out in the midst of a busy week where we can gather together, share the same spiritual space, and share one with another the ups and the downs, the highs and lows of this Christian journey that we walk together as we strive to become the people that God would have us be. We need a place where somebody knows our name. We need a place where when we feel untethered and lost, we know somebody will bring us a lifeline. We need a place where we can share what it is, how goes it with our soul. We need a place where we can share what it is to give and to receive grace. Mostly, we need a place we can share truly the ties that bind us together in Christian love. Now, it's not easy to let go of the noise, and it can be uncomfortable to embrace the silence. But this is where God works. This is where we can hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, and this is where we can experience not just what it is to be the hands and feet of Christ, but the very ears and voice of Christ. This is where our very presence can bring the love of God to another. And this is what I experienced in my own small class with Pastor Kate and Matt. And this is what we pray you'll experience in your own small class ministries. Thank you.
All right, here we go.
So this is just a testimony about me, like being in a small group and what's done for me?
Yeah.
Okay. Being in a small group has, like, it's given me more chances to talk to new people and meet new people that go to the church and learn more about people. And it gives me a chance to grow in my faith with these new people. And having a community of people around with you, it makes you want to keep going because you have a community with you there around you, surrounding you, and caring for you. And it's a big accountability, and you know that where you're going, you're safe, and that you can be yourself and love one another with just an utmost loving for God and have a good time with fellow Christians.
May we be a community that goes to the hard places that we encounter in life with brave grace, following our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Would you stand and join and sing our hymn of celebration?